Cool. So on in today's topic, we are going to discuss what is smart grid and its use cases in various applications, smart meters and its benefits, technical architecture of smart meters, and how do they connect to the cloud? What are the operational challenges which people face while operating on these smart meters in remote locations or not connected areas? And how do we solve those parts? I would now ask Ayush to start with its own part. Ayush, can you start it out? I think your video is not very clear, and I just want to update the audience as well. Unfortunately, Ayush has to travel to Assam for some urgent issue, so he might not be in a very good location.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Ayush Desai from Sinhala Udyog. I'm extremely sorry, I'm on a project site, so there might be a little bit disturbance on my audio or video. Please bear with me on that. And Siddharth, do let me know if I'm not audible or if I'm not clear in between.
Yes, Ayush. So you are audible as of now. Your video is not very clear. It seems that the light is very dull in the room.
Yes. So in Assam, what happens is, you know, by 4 o'clock, you have your sunlight disappearing.
Okay.
And yeah, I'm en route in a project area where there's not much light available to me.
Awesome. Sorry, and we are talking about smart grid. Wow. Irony. Okay. Yes, Ayush, we can start. I hope, guys, you can see my presentation and audio and video as well. Right? Please share in the chat window if there's some sort of disturbance. I'll take a look into it.
Great.
Okay. Yes. So as I mentioned, right, along with us, we have Ayush and myself. Now, this is what the agenda. We will be talking about smart grid and its use cases. What are smart meters? How do we role of edge gateways and its applications, challenging pertaining to these edge deployments of the whole IoT system, and how do we take care of it? Cool. Ayush, over to you.
So I would like to use this opportunity to introduce ourselves, our company. So we are part of a Crystal group. Crystal was started in 1982. We are pioneers in telecommunication. In telecommunication, we've been providing EPBX solution telecommunication services since past 3 decades in the country. Metering is a newborn baby, I'll call, which we started in 2011. So we started with smart grid in 2011, and as on date, we have nearly 200 plus team size. We are located, headquartered in Delhi, and we've been doing projects pan India. So one of the major area where we have worked is Delhi NCR. And second is the northeastern market. In northeastern market, specifically in Assam. So in Assam, we are doing a citywide deployment. I'll discuss about that more in detail in the later on slides.
Okay. Shall I move ahead?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So I would like to start with explaining what is smart grid. You know, so smart grid is nothing but an electricity grid, connected electricity grid, where we are getting a real-time information out of it. So if you're able to see the diagram in front of us, so we have renewable energy like solar, wind, you know, buildings, batteries, analytics, all combined and connected to a single grid, which is interactive, which is primarily real-time. And from a remote location, we are able to analyze and monitor what is happening with our grid. This fundamentally is what smart grid is all about. So, you know, electricity grid is one of the largest interconnected machine, and it is the most archaic system, I'll say, till now. So there's a lot of evolution that has happened in the last 1 decade. Our phones have become smart. We are using, you know, smart TVs everywhere. Our homes are becoming smart. But the electricity grid, the power grid, is still the same. It's same how it, since the day it was invented. So if you look at the technology intervention in the electricity grid, there hasn't been much since 1800s. So it is the same power line which is going. We have the distribution transformers, and we have definitely there is an efficiency which is coming in. but there's no drastic improvement in the technological side of it. So smart grid intends to change that. So these are few of the use cases of a smart grid. So demand side management is something. So what happens as on date is during a daytime when our factories are running, we have our offices running, the temperature is high, so air cons, air conditioners are on. So the demand is very high. So if you look at the graph, the electricity demand graph is at the peak. And same thing during the night time. You know, when you are at your houses, the temperature goes down, the factories are off, the offices are off. So the demand reduces significantly. Now, here you cannot store electricity at large. Like you don't have battery banks to store electricity of 10 megawatt or 100 megawatt or 1000 megawatt. So what you do is you shut down the generation plants at night and you run it at a peak during the day, so which is not efficient. So demand side management actually looks at flattening the curve, you know, where we say that your non-essential load can run during the night. So in future, you know, we'll have washing machines which is connected to the smart grid and they'll power them. So you load your clothes in the washing machine, they're connected to the smart grid. They'll know as soon as the load is low, they'll power themselves on. So this is what demand side management envisions at. Outage management is something that is very critical as on date. So we're looking at 24/7 power. And power is going to be as ubiquitous as air. You cannot survive without 24/7 power supply. We're talking about EVs. We're talking about electrical vehicles. So you cannot imagine power not be there in your premise, in your house for a night, or even for 3 hours, even for 4 hours. Cooking is being shifting to induction, which is again run on electricity. So our dependency on electricity is increasing day by day. So outage management is a part where the distribution company knows on a real-time basis if there's an outage or if there's a failure in the grid that is happening. So real-time information is again, so what we do is we have sensors, we place IoTs and sensors at different places strategically in the grid and we collate the data on a real-time basis so that we have the information to take action on time. And same goes in for public lighting. You know, as on date, we don't know when the... In metro cities, you might have noticed a lot of times that the street lights are even on during the daytime. So that is wastage of resources. We are landing up wasting electricity. So this is something, again, which smart grid looks at solving. We have our public lighting and all the utilities connected to the grid, and we have the information on real time that what is being used, when it is being used. Renewable energy. With the climate accord coming in, with the countries signing and having a dedicated target of reducing the carbon footprint, so renewable energy has a very important role in every country's vision. So currently, you cannot just go and plug solar at every rooftop. You need to have an infrastructure to support that. So this is what again smart grid does. So what happens, I'll give you a small example of a blockchain. So what is happening is with all the solar rooftop energy, mini generation units, they'll act as a blockchain ledger account. And whatever electricity is being produced over there, it's a unit. And whoever is consuming it can be completely tracked using blockchain. So we are doing a pilot in UP where we are implementing blockchain for the rooftop solar. So it's a very interesting project, I think. So I'll share that on a separate note. Yep. So if you can move in. Okay. So when we talk about all the applications that we discussed on the previous slide, let it be demand management, let it be outage information or renewable energy, the key implementer for any of these technologies is a smart meter. So smart meter is a building block of a smart grid. Or without smart meters, you cannot do any of most of the applications which smart grid envisions. So India has taken a very aggressive path to convert 250 million connection to smart energy meters in next 3 years, which is a very ambitious plan. And they claim that this is the only way to save the Indian electricity grid and to save the distribution companies from making losses. So I just want to explain you fundamentally what a smart meter is and what it does. So it is nothing but energy meter is a sensor. Its job is to sense electricity, the flow of electricity, and measure the flow of electricity. And when we add communication to it, it becomes an IoT. So in a layman term, any sensor which is capable of measuring electricity and has a two-way communication, or which is an IoT, is a smart meter. On the hardware side, we have an additional functionality, which is a load switch. So what happens with the load switch is it's able to, you know, disconnect the electricity of a household. So this is what a smart meter is. Now, okay, so one of the use cases that we had of a smart grid was outage management. So now what happens with a smart meter is as soon as the power it disconnected from an energy meter, it sends an alarm. It sends an alert to a remote system that there's an outage that is taking place. So fundamentally, initially, what used to happen was agar aapke ghar pe bijli nahi hoti thi, so you had to call the distribution company provider, talk to them, inform them that there's no electricity in our house. And then they used to take an action. But now the smart meter is on a real-time basis. Within a minute, it's sending an alarm, it's sending an alert to a remote system saying that there's an outage that has taken place, so that you can immediately take an action. Sorry, Siddharth, can you be on the previous slide itself? Yeah, thank you. So this improved the customer satisfaction phenomenally. So now the customer don't have to go to the utility or the distribution company for the complaint. The distribution company themselves, they are aware of what is happening in the location. After that, we have, so these are energy meters, you know, you can run them as a prepayment meters. Prepayment is, that means it is a pay as you go service. So once you enable prepayment, your cash flow for a utility improves drastically. Load management, which is again demand side management, which I was talking about. So in future, what is going to happen is, let's say you are a customer who is willing to participate for a demand side management. So during a daytime, when the peak demand is high, so the distribution companies want you to reduce the demand. So what they'll say is, okay, right now you have a 5 kilowatt demand. That means you hypothetically you're running 2 air conditioner, 1 refrigerator, 1, you know, some other load taking device. So we tell you to reduce the demand by 5 kilowatt to 4 kilowatt, you know, and we'll incentivize you in some way. We'll give you a rebate. We'll give you some points to that. And you can do that very easily. You can just reduce your temperature of your aircon from 22 degrees Celsius to 24 degrees Celsius, which will help you in reducing the your consumption by 1 kilowatt. And this will help the grid to flatten the peak demand. So this is something that can be done through smart meter. Because what happens is, immediately you send a command to the smart meter by curtailing the load to 4 kilowatt. So as soon as your load increases from 4 to 5, it will disconnect the supply. And as soon as you reduce the load, it will initiate the supply. So this is what the demand side management is, and this is how it has been fulfilled using a smart meter. Okay, going to the next slide. For customers, okay, now during lockdown, I don't know how many of you have faced this. So there was a lot of inflated bills coming in. So I did read a lot of messages in Twitter where people from Mumbai, they were complaining on extraordinary bills coming in, where, you know, on an average, their electricity bills were around 500, 600 rupees but they were getting bills in the tune of thousands of rupees. Or, you know, there were cases where no one was staying in the house during the lockdown and still they were getting electricity bills. So these things happen because they don't have any real-time information. So in India, what happens is every month someone goes to your premise, someone visits your premise, takes down the reading, comes back, generates the bill and sends it to you. So during COVID, when there was no one going to your house, so this was the major challenge that was happening. So with the smart meter, what is happening is we have communication established to a remote system. So we are sending the meter information to a remote system, which enables, you know, to have accurate billing at any time. So you increase the customer satisfaction extremely. Then, you know, you have a mobile app. The mobile app gives a transparency. It adds a layer of transparency where you're able to see and actually monitor your consumption on real-time basis. So, you know, this adds a level of trust between the distribution company and between the consumer. And luckily, we have power over here. Thank you so much for that. Okay. So, prepayment, postpayment, the consumer has an option to go in for a prepayment meter because, you know, through a remote command, you can actually configure all the meters to a prepayment or postpayment by a single click of command. So this is all possible because of meters being an IoT. And how we do that, I'll come to that now. So going to the next slide. Okay, so just a brief about how the government has been able to manage all this. So if you see, surprisingly, India is losing $1.6 billion every year on distribution of electricity. If I translate to INR, that is roughly 1.5 crores or somewhere around 2 lakh crores yearly losses in revenue that we have today. So electricity on an average is being produced at 2.5 rupees, 3 rupees. We are buying it at around 7 rupees to 8 rupees, but still every distribution company is at loss. The reason is because there's no efficiency in the system. It's an old system. So that with a smart meter, you have data coming in. If there's any tampering, you have that information on a real-time basis. You know, this will enable the distribution company to cut their losses. This will enable the distribution company to supply electricity at a much, much lower cost. This will allow the electricity companies to have a good customer experience, to give customers the ease of use of electricity. You know, there'll be no more estimated billing. There'll be no more manual billing. Everything is every information is being sent on a real-time basis to a central system, which automates your billing. And more than anything, if there's any theft that is happening. So these energy meters, these sensors, they have a lot of features inbuilt to identify theft. So if there's any theft, if there's any tampering happening on the grid, so there's an alarm that has been raised instantaneously. By instantaneously, the alarm has to be relayed to the system within a minute. So you have information to take action on. So this is the biggest advantage in India for a smart grid. Okay, going to the next slide. So this is an architecture that we follow. So we have smart meters, you know. So now to send the data to a remote server. So there are three primary areas. One, we call it a smart meter. Then we have a communication layer. The communication layer is responsible for getting the data to a remote location. Then we have a cloud infrastructure where we have all the software running, a billing software, analytics software, there's an ERP running, you know, there is a data management system which is there. So traditionally, a smart grid is divided into three parts. One is the sensors, which is the hardware smart meters. Then there's a communication layer. And then there's a cloud infrastructure, which consists of all the software, analytics system. Sorry. Now, coming to the smart meters. So to relay the smart meter data to the cloud, you have an option of either going installing a modem in every meter. So the easiest option is you buy a you have a 2G or 3G or a 4G modem running in every meter, which communicates to the cloud infrastructure directly. And the second way is you create a NAN, neighboring area network, which is something that we prefer. In 95% of the projects, we go in for a NAN network. So what we do over here is we create a wireless network. You know, this is created over the license-free band, that is 865 megahertz or, you know, 2.4 gigahertz. So 2.4 gigahertz is fairly very crowded. So we prefer 865 megahertz. It's a license-free band. So what happens is these energy meters, which is represented on the leftmost side of this diagram, all of these meters, they have a RF NAN module communication card installed with them. You know, they form a mesh network, so they interconnect with themselves, and then there's an edge gateway in that network. So this edge gateway is a beautiful piece of hardware. So what it does is on the southbound, that is between the meter and the edge, the communication takes place over RF. Then on the northbound, we call the northbound as edge and the head end system or the cloud infrastructure, the communication takes place over WAN, that is 4G, 3G, 2G. You know, so generally one edge gateway can take can cater up to 3,000 smart meters. So you know, if you have to look at that in the geographical point of view, so you can cover up to 25 square kilometer radius by one edge gateway. So in our edge gateway, to assure the northbound communication, you can put in Ethernet, you can have multiple WAN working in. So, you know, what we do in field is we always have a two dual network provider working on it. So we have one Airtel, we have one Vodafone running on the edge gateway, you know, to ensure that there's a 100% connectivity to the head end system. And on the other side, it's our own private network running on RF. So we have that control over it. So edge is a piece of hardware which has to be 100% on. You know, because if this edge goes down, the meters behind it, 3,000 meters connected to it, goes down. So I'll give you an example. So let's say in a prepayment scenario, okay, one of the energy meter is disconnected. So the balance of the energy meter was low. The billing system checked, okay, the balance is minus 200. So it sent a command to disconnect the load of that meter. Now the energy of this meter has been disconnected. Now the user comes home, he sees there's no power in his house. He immediately goes and recharges his account. So as soon as he recharges the account, if the edge is down, you know, the command won't be relayed to that energy meter. So which is not acceptable. So that is why edge is a very mission critical device. It has to be on, it has to be serviceable every time. Okay, coming to the next slide. So this is how our edge gateway looks like. You know, on the hardware side, so these are, so this is manufactured, designed and manufactured by us. And they are dual core, 1 gigahertz processor is built in. They have a 2 GB RAM, and then they have around 16 GB memory, onboard memory in it. And they have 4G connectivity for the northbound, and they have RF over the southbound. And you know, they have a battery backup. They have a 4-hour battery backup in them. And these are mounted on poles. So these are IP65 rated enclosures. And they are rugged devices. The hardware is a very robust and rugged device, which can endure the field conditions and, you know, be on for continuously for 10 years or 12 years. Okay. So now there's a choice that any solution provider has to make. We have a mesh network running to actually collate the data of the smart meters and give it to the cloud system. So we can either manage that network by running an application on the cloud, or we can unburden the cloud or and run the same application on the edge. So this is what we do. So instead of having a network management running on the cloud, we run the network management on the edge. So the advantage of it is we have a purely decentralized network. Let's say if we have the network management system running on the cloud, one of the biggest drawback is that we have a fixed routing table, and if the cloud goes down, then I don't have any routing information available with me. So now what we have done is we have a decentralized network. So with a decentralized network, if anything goes down, you still have a availability of the network. So let's say one of the edge goes down, then the meter automatically connects to another edge gateway. So that's the beauty of a decentralized network. So what we have done is we have created all the network management activity on the edge device itself. So this enables us to have a very low and lean cloud infrastructure. We have a very low operational cost for the solution. So there's another fundamental change with the customer these days. The customer is not looking for a product. What we have understood is the customer is looking for a service. So 10 years back, a decade back, when I was in business, I used to see that we were looking at selling a product. We were looking at selling a meter. We were looking at selling an EPBS. Or we were looking at selling a telecommunication product. But now it has changed to service. So what they're saying is we need smart grid as a service. We don't care what hardware you're going to install behind it, what sensors you want to install behind it. You give us smart grid as a service. So what I want is I want the data to be available with me for next 10 years. So it is a job of us as a solution provider to implement something which is robust enough to and which has a very low cost of ownership for a period of 10 years or 12 years, whatever lifetime you have. So what we have done is all the meters, the routing on the all the meters are based on IPv6, and they are self-healing and self-forming. So what we mean by self-healing or self-forming is there is no fixed routing how the energy meter connects to an edge. So this happens on the fly. So any energy meter actually looks at the neighboring link, and depending on the link quality, it connects itself. And then there's intelligence in the edge to actually define if this meter route is the best path or not. So on the edge, we have AES-128-bit encryption running. So any communication that is happening with the server or that is happening with the meter is AES-128-bit encrypted. So security is a very important feature in a smart grid. So in 2002, I'll give you an example. In 2012, when America started rolling out smart meters, so there was a very interesting theft that happened. So these malicious users, what they did was they hacked into the edge devices, and then they decoded the information which was being relayed. Now doing that, what happened was they were able to find out if there's any consumption of electricity in a particular house or not. So let's say there's a house number 405. So they go outside 405, they hack into the smart grid system, they check if there's any consumption of electricity happening at 405. If there is no consumption of electricity happening in that house, that means there's no owner or there's no occupant in that house. There's no one staying in that house currently. So that means it's an easy target for robbery. So this is one of the cases, which you can, how you can maliciously take advantage of a smart grid by hacking into it. So that is why we have all the communication that is taking place using an AES-128-bit encryption. And this is ensured by the edge gateway that we have. So another important thing that we do is, so we are transmitting simultaneously over 40 channels. So let us say if any malicious user wants to block a channel, so the edge is capable enough to understand and detect if there's any external device blocking a particular radio channel. If that happens, the edge is smart enough to shift to another channel and all the meters shift to the other channel. So this ensures that, you know, there's no blocking that is taking place. Again, a critical point is scalability, because in India itself, we're talking about 250 million smart meters in the next 3 years. So whatever system that you have should be scalable for millions or billions of devices. So which again solves using an edge, because you're reducing the load from a cloud, you're reducing the dependency of the cloud, and you're moving it towards the edge itself. So this is where ICANN comes in and helps us, you know, monitor the edge. So for now, currently in the smart grid project that we have in Assam that we have rolled out, we have already deployed close to around 80 or 90 edge devices. And our plan is to deploy nearly 1,000 devices. So ICANN gives us a tool. ICANN enables us to monitor these devices remotely. Another thing to ensure the lifetime of these devices is remote firmware upgrade. And as we talk, as we spoke about or discussed about the security angle of these devices, so ICANN gives us a very robust model for, you know, for firmware upgrade of these devices. Then there are analytics. Network health is again one of the key things that we are able to see. So, you know, what happens is we have 4G or 2G or 3G for the northbound connectivity of the edge to the cloud. So let's say we have Airtel or Vodafone running in one of the edge. So ICANN gives us a, you know, in a single screen, we are able to see what was the uptime of the network so that we can take an informed decision if the network provider is good or not in that particular area where the edge is installed. And then we have a very very decent user experience with the portal that we get. So combining these, all these, as I told you that the customer is expecting solution as a service. So this reduces the total cost of ownership. So I think so Siddharth can explain more on this.
Sure. Thanks, Ayush. Thanks a lot for explaining to us what exactly are smart grids, smart meters. It definitely invokes a thoughts in my mind as well that, okay, we definitely need more and more of smart grids or meters coming into place. And there are many states which are lacking that. Good that Assam has adopted and many other states have adopted. And I, honestly speaking, I didn't know that ICANN is solving such a mission critical problem for Crystal Power. So, Thank you for giving us this opportunity. Hi guys, I'm Siddharth again. So let me start explaining about what exactly ICANN is. Some portion of it is being already explained by Ayush. I'll just very briefly explain to you what we do at ICANN. So ICANN is a software solution. It's a completely software solution to monitor, manage, securely access and upgrade an array of remotely deployed IoT devices and edge applications. So we work across the horizon of edge computing. You start with IoT gateways, the classic example what Ayush is using to do a network, running network management systems in these gateways itself. Edge servers, you talk about robotic arms, automated guided vehicles, e-vehicles, connected vehicles, retail, vending machines, surveillance, predominantly computer vision, machine vision, and drones. All these are classic examples where your edge applications, which was previously on the cloud, is now running on these embedded devices or edge devices itself. Now, when these applications runs, it becomes very essential and very critical for you to manage and monitor these applications remotely and devices remotely. And that's what ICANN do. Now, if you see in all of these use cases, right, what is unique is a hardware and OS and an application running onto it. Like what Ayush mentioned, in a smart grid, they run an IoT gateway or a different built hardware with application as network management system. So that's what you see here. Hardware is different and application is different. But what is common across all these use cases, all these edge computing use cases, which I explained to you, is all of them have to take care of privacy and security once deployed on field. They have to make sure that they are able to remotely connect to these devices, remotely access these edge devices, remotely do a monitoring of applications, devices, and network altogether. And then upgrades. Upgrades are very, very essential. Reliable upgrades and weak networks are very essential. So that's what is the common part, and that's what I can do. So that for you, if you have the hardware, if you know what applications you want to move to edge, that's it. That's the only thing. We will bring everything else into picture. Now, how it works, I'll take the context of only smart meters as well. So what we do is we deploy our agents onto these edge gateways, what being manufactured by Ayush or other SoCs as well. So we help you to, we deploy these edge gateways, and then these software agents, and then from the cloud is where we help you to monitor not only the gateways, but also the peripheral connected devices, these meters as well, or maybe some other IoT devices altogether. That's what how ICON works it out. I'll very quickly take you through the demo as well of this solution, what we have in place. Okay. I hope you guys can see my screen here. So this is what you see, right? The agents are deployed on total 6 devices as of now. 2 are connected, 4 are not connected. Where are they? All they located based on IP address? How many profiles predominantly? So you could group your devices based on profiles. These are the applications running from the customer side. So Ayush would be, or Crystal Power would be running network management applications on these gateways. If it's a computer vision or machine vision, you would be running phase detection, mass detection application, or quality assessment applications. These could be any applications which you run, and ICON monitors them. Going inside the tool, you could inside the devices, you could see which one are up, down. The one which are up, you can remotely connect to them. You could do SSH to these devices. No requirement of additional VPN services required. I can just log in here itself directly with a single click. Okay. Then you have tags, which helps you to manage or essentially filter out devices when you have thousands of these devices in place. I want to upgrade all the devices which are in Bangalore and are running certain version of applications. You can just filter them out using the tags, which are customizable. Going inside the devices, you have complete details of the interfaces, the devices has. You can execute command here itself. I want to execute Alice or any command or scripts you want to execute. You can just execute on these gateways directly from the cloud. Right? You can open device ports as well. So if some of your application are throwing data to specific ports, locally, you can open those ports remotely to check it out what the data type is looking out for. So this is again what Ayush was talking about, the network uptime and how is it behaving. So if you see here, right, today is 11th of November and every brick is 1 hour. So at ICON, you can see where exactly is the network or the device uptime good or not. So it's all good here. The network or the device went down on 21st of October between 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. It was only 70%, 1% up. Clicking on this specific brick, you will find out what exactly happened. Was it a device went down? Was it a power issue? Was it a network issue? Or maybe your application crashing? That's the reason it's not able to connect to the cloud itself. So by clicking here, you will find out the reasons as well. We generate all the events which are required. So more than 150 type of events based on system, network, and application health are being generated here. You get to know complete visualizations of how your CPU, the performance of these devices are happening with respect to CPU, memory, load, data consumption, network speed, and all together. Logs of all your the system logs, network log, application logs can be pulled up here directly. You don't have to go to each of these devices to find it out. And any errors or warnings occurring in these logs will be pushed to an event or notification. And then subsequently, you can start raising tickets from here directly. Or you can have it on a mail or in a Slack channel, wherever you want, wish to have these logs or events be. You can add new logs from directly here. That's another thing. add new logs and applications. Now here is where you are monitoring your applications. Now in these mission critical applications like what Ayush mentioned about, right, these edge devices, it's very important to make sure that your applications are also running and the performance of these applications are also up to the mark. And that's what we very reliably do for you. So I am monitoring this application called Docker, which is again another application, normal application, Docker application. So you could see how much resource consumption each of your applications are doing. And if they crash or if they fail or if they go beyond the SLAs, you will get an immediate alert on these devices as well. You can control these, your container applications directly from here. Upgrade happens automatically of your container applications from here itself. All these things happen. Now, I'll quickly take you to the OTA part, deployments part, okay? Yeah, so what is required to do an upgrade is just, you have to just give us a package file which has to be upgraded. A package file could be a file you want to just push it to these devices, or it could be a script which you want to run, configuration file, could be any application, native application, Docker application, or if it's an Android device, it could be an APK as well. So you have to just give us a package of the file which has to be deployed to hundreds and thousands of your edge devices. With a single click, we pick it up and then start deploying it to those devices you choose to be deployed to. And you will have a complete status of each of your deployments as well. So here you could see, right? One, we have deployed it in one device and it all went successfully. It took 56 seconds to deploy this to that specific devices. All the states are in mind. And you can check out the logs as well. Maybe a success log, failure logs, or why is it skipped as well. That's predominantly what we do in the edge segment, help you. And yes, this is a very important part. Like as what Ayush said, it is important to see or check out the reports of these devices, where it's working, not working. So you can predominantly get to know, or you can download the reports of the complete, the set of your devices in a group as well. So as I want a report from device uptime, when was my device in this group up or not? So you could see I'm generating a report of CPU uptime, CPU usage of these devices in this group. This is then one device is off, the others are there. So you can export it in Excel and then send it to a higher management or maybe to the government sites as well, government people or agencies as well in case of what Crystal Power is doing. So that to make sure that, okay, everything is in place and everything is running well as well. Yeah, I think this is a very quick demo of what ICON is, what are its capabilities, and would happy to hear from you if you have any edge deployments and wish to use this system altogether. You can directly, you could say, try it out at experience.icon.io. I'll start taking up questions from here now. Okay, let me do that. Let me see if there's any questions in the chat. Yes. Ayush, question to you. Are you considering eSIM with auto fallback between two operators in the edge?
Interesting question, you know. So we feel eSIM is going to be a savior for the edge devices because, yes, you very rightly, as you pointed out, eSIM with an auto switchover between networks will ensure that you have a 99% plus SLA or connectivity between the edge and the cloud. So we are very actively working towards the eSIM network. I think currently in India, Tata TCS is working, you know, giving us the bundled solution. So we have integrated our edge with them. And yes, very soon, I think so we should be able to have a production ready device with the eSIM. So yes, a very, very interesting take towards the solving the problem between the connectivity of edge and the cloud.
Makes sense. Cool. Again, then another question for you, Ayush, is how safe are these after we have seen ESSL meters being hacked? So how safe are smart meters after we have seen these meters from ESSL being hacked up before, I think some time back. Yeah.
So theoretically, on paper, the security, as I even discussed in between, security is a paramount feature around which the smart grid is designed on. So, basically what happens is all the communication that we have is built using AES 128-bit encryption. More than that, any data that comes out of the smart meter or any configuration that goes inside the smart meter, let's say if we have to disconnect the supply of the energy meter, so these follow an IEC standard. You know, there's an IEC 60253 or 56. I don't know that number exactly right now, but it is called DLMS. So, DLMS ensures that there's a particular method that any communication, any configuration goes to an energy meter. So let's say if you have to disconnect the supply of the energy meter. So what happens is there's a handshake between the cloud and the energy meter. There's a token exchange between the energy meter and the cloud. And then, there's ciphering implemented, there's a key implemented, the key, there's a validity of the key. So all these communications, there's a foolproof way of doing it. But where we lack is the human process on the human side. So the lacuna is not on the system, but the lacuna is currently on the way humans interact with the smart grid. So what we feel is the challenge or the problem in UP, what happened was primarily due to a human error, not because of the smart grid error. So what we feel is we have to, have a more matured processes in place rather than a system.
Good. Now another question is, containerization is in smart meters or edge device. I'll take it up. Smart meters are not capable enough from the resource perspective to run container applications on these meters. They are predominantly running on microcontrollers and the collection of data is happening. Collection of data from the sensor nodes is happening from these smart meters. The intelligence or the brain is in the edge device. So you've been running container applications on these edge devices itself. That's where it happens. Yeah.
And another thing is, so the containerization also happens in the cloud. Where we have the analytics and the head-end system with the meter data management system running.
Right.
So that is again where the containerization is taking place for a horizontal scalable system.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. So another question for you: how are you addressing remote connectivity challenges, Ayush? So I think you partially answered it. You're saying that mesh solves that problem for you. But maybe is there any way where you see that, okay, with mesh also you're only getting 99.99% reliability, or how accurate is this for you?
There are two portions to it. One is the southbound and one is the northbound. So when we talk about the southbound connectivity, so we have a beautiful RF mesh that we have designed, a decentralized RF mesh. So, which, there were two keywords mentioned in that, which is self-healing and self-forming. So let's say there's 1 meter which goes down, there's a particular node that goes down, it automatically finds a new route. So there's no centralized routing table. So that solves the connectivity on the southbound. On the northbound, so we have the edge devices and we are monitoring the edge devices for the connectivity, what someone writes. We are trying to get into eSIM, where we have switch over between 2 or 3 network providers happening automatically.
Got it. So another question is, when you say edge, so when you say edge has a radius of 25 kilometers, do you mean, is it clear line of sight?
Hello?
Yeah, Ayush, can you hear my question?
Sorry. Yeah, I lost you in between over there. I heard your question.
Yeah.
Sorry, it is not a clear line of sight. So what happens is this is a mesh network. So we call edge and the first device needs to be between a radius of 500 meters or 600 meters. After that, you can have the next device between 500 meters. So in our mesh, you can have unlimited hops. So that is how, you know, you cover a radius of 25 square kilometers. So it is, so the answer is no, it is not clear line of sight 25 kilometers. It is using hops, using mesh. Oh,
got it. And
so for, to cover a radius of 25 kilometers, so theoretically you'll have around 50 to 60 hops. So let's say there's a energy meter that's located 25 kilometers away from the edge. By 25 kilometer, I say like if the crow, if I calculate the distance as the crow flies, then there might be, 30 or 40 or maybe 50, 60 smart meters relaying that message.
Got it. So another question is, why using mesh and not LoRa or WLAN? So I think WLAN, you answered it out. Why not LoRa?
LoRa, yes, it's a very interesting technology. The ease of deployment is very, is there. So ease of deployment is again a very important factor when considering smart grid technologies, because you're supposed to roll out millions of devices in a very short span of time, and you have to reduce the total cost of ownership. So what happens in LoRa is a star network, which is point to point. So every energy meter has to have a line of sight or a direct connectivity with the edge. So if that doesn't happen, there's no way to optimize it or add the meters which are outliers. So let us say if we have 100 smart meters, then all the 100 have to be directly connected to the edge.
Got it.
So this is why, with a mesh, what happens is, if there's let's say 3 or 4 houses that you've not been able to cover, you can add repeaters, you can add routers to ensure that they connect to the mesh, they connect to the network. So this is why we prefer mesh over LoRaWAN. A mesh over any star network, basically, not LoRaWAN specifically.
Yeah, makes sense. Cool. Another interesting question which came up, Ayush, is again for you. So IPv6 has maximum of 200 devices in 1 kilometer radius. How do you assure 25 kilometer radius without interruption?
Sorry, I didn't get that question.
Sure. IPv6 has maximum of 200 devices in 1 kilometer radius. I'm not sure whether the fact is correct or not. How do you assure 25 kilometer radius without interruption? Is it clear now?
See, the 25 kilometer radius is taking place
mesh.
Using the mesh, because we have multiple hops. But IPv6 can have unlimited devices. So why we shifted from IPv4 to IPv6 was one of the primary reasons was of the addressing challenge. Because IPv4 had a limitation on the number of devices that can connect to their network. But with IPv6, you have infinite addressing. So you can cover, it is said that every grain of sand can be addressed using an IPv6 addressing format.
Right. Makes sense. Okay. I think we have one more from Surya. If edge goes down, then it takes down close to 3,000 meters. If it's GPRS, then probably only the one that is having will go down. I think, Surya, the same thing, right? What Ayush mentioned before as well. Even if this edge gateway door goes down, the meters connect to the another gateway, which is in the close proximity, instantaneously. So
that's the beauty of a decentralized network.
Right,
so you don't have any fixed routing. You don't have a dedicated or fixed routing. On the fly, it can change. So if something happens that edge is down, automatically it connects to the different gateway, and till the time you go and fix that edge. This is how we've been able to manage a 99% SLA, 99% 99 plus SLA.
Makes sense. Yeah, that's a good number. Cool. I think we are done on questions as well, and we are right on time as well. If there's no further questions, I would like to first thank you for a wonderful information session which you have given to all of us. And thanks, audience, for hooking around and then listening to us.
And thank you so much. I have seen some very interesting questions, coming our way, especially the eSIM one, the edge going down. You know, these are genuine things. I think that if we would have had these webinars earlier in our project cycles, we would have taken care of them initially rather than discovering these problems and then fixing them.
That's a good thing. So Ayush, with this, right, I would at least to our audience, I would love to know, so what would be the starting point if someone wants to try these things out? Like how do they start it out? So is there some sort of proper documentation around, and when I'm talking about these things, I'm talking about more prominently from the mesh networking side in specifically in the meter side. What could be the failure and how do you overcome that? So is it always through learning, or do you get those things in as a part of some courses or material, something like that?
So one good thing is there's an IEEE standard, which is 802, which is the same standard for Wi-Fi.
Got it.
So Wi-Fi is covered under 802. I'm very bad with numbers.
Okay. So
there's a particular IEEE standard. Uh-huh. So if you change the last two digits to 14G, uh-huh, that is the mesh framework that we use.
Right.
So, you know, IEEE over the course of last decade or so, they have a very, very matured guidelines that what your mesh should be capable of doing. Mm-hmm. So because this mesh is not used only for metering. They are a part for any IoT. So we're talking about Industry 4.0 these days. So Industry 4.0 have millions of sensors connected to the system. So these sensors, and they need to relay the information at a very low latency. So again, this happens due to the mesh that you have. So IEEE standard is something, you know, that you should go through if anyone wants to understand the mesh or work towards this mesh network.
Got it. I think this makes better sense. Thank you guys again for joining in the session, and have a very good evening and keep up safe. Thank you. Thank you, Will.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Ayush. Bye.